Welcome back to Dan on Dev. We are continuing our Why All Application Products Sucks series. Today we are going to be focusing on why all RASP products suck. The RASP stands for Real-Time Application Security Protection, also known as the Next-Gen WAF, or Web Application Firewall. We're going to be going into detail about this. This will be the last of the product categories. I'm planning to have another episode where we'll be talking with others. We'll bring in some other folks. But in the meantime, we're going to talk about RASP products. Again, this is not necessarily to bash on any one product category, or any of them at all, really. The idea here is not just to talk about why they suck. It's really to go into the fact that there is no one tool that will solve all the problems. You are going to need to understand what each tool does, what it doesn't do. You're really going to want to look at each of the product categories and work out what tools are going to work for you. There's a lot of details to that. I use this example over and over here. It's the idea that even if you told somebody to build a house and they could only pick one tool, they're likely to fail. Relying on just one tool is a recipe for failure. You want to understand the tools, understand what they do, what works for what problem, and you're looking at the collection. Security in general is about layers and going through the different layers and the different categories of problems. Application security is no different. It's about the layers. So we're not focusing on just one tool. There are an alphabet soup of solutions. There are some subcategories, but the primary ones here are the static analysis, DAST, IAST, SCA, WAF, and now we're going to be talking about RASP, and then there's also manual pen testing. So we'll be talking about that as well. Each of these different categories do different things, and they solve different problems. They try to attack the problem in different ways, so you really want to look at all the layers that are there and what you need to do. So that's the general premise. 101 on RASP. The way a RASP works, I hate RASP, it's hard to say it all the time, but the way they work is that they actually attach to the application itself while it's running and monitor the activity coming in, monitor the inputs, monitor the data coming in. It's a great spot to understand what's going on. I kind of use the analogy of the alien is like attached to the brain and is able to kind of control the person, control them, use them as a robot, if you will, right? They are the ones now in control. That's not entirely true. It's not really in control, but it is controlling some behavior under certain circumstances. So if it sees an attack, it can kind of block it, okay? Now, why, that sounds great, right? That sounds fantastic, amazing, cool idea, and it is. And I actually think RASP is really key. But here's the problems. If you remember back when I talked about the IAST, the instrumented application security testing, the IAST has an agent. RASP also has an agent in the same basic fashion. It needs to attach to it so that it can actually monitor the activity and take actions to block attacks. So the idea that you could do that is fantastic, but that means you need to install this on your running application. So you need to coordinate this with whoever is going to be running, whoever writes the code has to coordinate it with the person running it, potentially has to get put in the build process. It does risk stability issues, performance issues. I know the vendors are going to say that that doesn't happen and it's theory. Fine. That they may have solved a lot of the problems, but it is still a concern. And I'm sure there are people out there that have had challenges with it breaking the application. I've definitely heard of that where it creates bugs in a sense because it's changing the behavior of the application and it may not understand what it's doing or why. So maybe pretty mild, but it's an issue. And then there's also the performance hit. Again, those are usually pretty minor, but it is a concern, especially in a real high performance application. That could end up being kind of a make it or break it kind of thing. But those are some of the challenges there. Also, like the IAST, and even with SAS, the static analysis, where you're looking at the code, well, sorry, on the IAST, it only works with interpreted languages, okay? I actually said this at a conference. I was talking about this, and Jeff Williams mentioned that they now support Go, which is not technically an interpreted language, but it's still kind of on the fence there. But it needs to work with interpreted languages. It's useless to you if you're writing your applications in languages that are not supported. That's an issue. You got to look at what they list off as what frameworks that they support, what languages, and then what frameworks that they support, because they do need to kind of understand the framework as well. So there's a lot of nuance. You need to make sure that it supports it. I've mentioned this before when I looked at the IAST and even the static analysis tools. There's a breadth versus depth challenge. And what I mean there is it is difficult. It's almost impossible. I mean, without just lots and lots of time and lots of resources to solve both at the same time. Generally, you have to pick your battle. Are you taking this language and you're going to solve everything on this given language? You're going to work through all of the frameworks, understand all of the possible scenarios, look at all the details of the language, the syntax, the functions, all the popular libraries, all of that in depth. Or are you going to try to support a whole bunch of languages, right? So that you're somewhat useful for lots of people or very, very good for some. Doing both is very difficult. You just need lots of time and resources. So there's going to be limitations. They have to make calls on this, right? Whether they want to talk about it or not, they have to make calls. You need to find out, is your language supported to the depth that you need it? You may not need it to be 100%. Maybe you're not even using the language, you know, odd things in the language. So that's totally fine. Okay. So the breadth and depth that I've mentioned before falls into play here. You need to be concerned about that. The other problem that I have with the RASP solutions is that for the way that you build applications these days, the modern applications are often built in a ton of microservices that are kind of scattered out and they're calling into each other. It's a whole bunch of different pieces. These pieces may be even written in different languages. And through the microservices architecture, kind of doesn't matter, except for to something like a RASP, where it needs to have an agent on each of these things. And so you have to have agents on each little microservice to protect their part. And again, you have to make sure that the language for that service is enabled, or you're just not going to end up having RASP protection over there. So this is another little challenge that you got to sort through and understand. So as we said, breadth and depth, you know, again, on each of those microservices, you have the breadth and depth problem. So you need to make sure that it's all sorted out. Why they rock. What I love about this is the right place. If you watch the episode about web application firewalls, the WAFs, I didn't have a lot of good things to say because they're too early in the process. RASP is not. RASP is at the right place, in my opinion. They have already bypassed HTTP parsing, so they could see the actual data going into the application. They can deal with all of the data structures that the application is seeing. So they don't miss things the same way a WAF would, a traditional WAF. There tends to be less training because, again, they're right at the application. They can see where it's trying to, where inputs are being attacked, and can block it right there. So there's generally a lot of less training than you would have with a traditional WAF. There still is some training because they need to see the application under good activity. They generally do want to learn. They can often do that in a self-learning, but they have to time it so that learning is happening while there's definitely no attacks happening. You know, I've seen some will actually try to like do a lot of crawl activity, run it in a safe environment, so that it builds up its knowledge of the application and what like good behavior looks like. But it's a lot easier to do than it is, as it would be to a WAF, a traditional WAF. You could track the data moving through the code, so you may be able to see the input comes in here, makes its way to this SQL statement over here, and if you're connected to the SQL driver, you can actually see if it's actually getting through any kind of like filtering in the code. So there's some really cool stuff you can see. I think it's a fantastic strategy, the way things need to be going. And you can also be very strategic about what gets blocked. Again, with a WAF, you're kind of very broad. You're you're having to create these filters that are looking for these attack payloads wherever they come. And you could write individual filters, but it is really a pain on a WAF. In a RASP, I think it's a lot easier to drill in and say, okay, well, let's apply some, you know, stronger protection of this little area, because you have kind of a nice little crawl map, and you have the code routes, and you can kind of see what's going on. So I think that's helpful. It is also just generally a super cool concept, a super cool way to solve things. I really do think that as it continues to improve, this is the general direction to go. So I think this is why it rocks. Again, you may not be able to put a WAF or a RASP in there, and you then need to rely on a WAF, a traditional WAF. And a lot of these RASP vendors, they actually do have an inline WAF component that's available, just in case the RASP isn't able to be installed in a certain environment. So again, no one tool is going to solve all your problems. So understanding the layers is going to be really helpful. So it's, again, about picking the right tool for the job. You want to do that so that, you know, if you're picking the right tool for the job and you understand that this is all complex, it needs multiple tools, the right tools will help you do the best possible job. So understanding what each tool does well, what it doesn't, is really what I'm after here. Thank you for joining Dan on Dev. If you wouldn't mind, I really appreciate the follows, the likes, comments, anything like that. As I'm kind of building the channel and getting things going, I'm going to have to beg for likes like everybody else on YouTube. So again, appreciate your time. Thank you for joining. This has been Dan on Dev.